Hi guys, welcome to my kitchen area. Today I thought I would show you how to make a quiche in a bucket oven. So it's currently Wimbledon at the moment. I'm a huge fan. A bit sad Federer isn't in it this year. Very sad Nadal went out with injury. But I thought I would make myself something to snack on whilst I watch the final with my beer in hand. I've got some vegetables that need using up, so I thought I'd make a quiche. Now, on my old channel, I know I did upload a video about how to use the bucket oven, but I don't think I actually cooked anything in it. So this time around, from beginning to end, I'm going to show you how I make a quiche. If you're a chef, if you're a professional cook, look away now. It is not finesse. I am not somebody who cooks for the pleasure of cooking. I'm somebody who cooks for the necessity of staying alive. And my presentation style very much reflects that. So I'm going to just do that and show you how the bucket oven actually does work in practice, not just in theory. And then hopefully I'll have something to nibble on tomorrow. So in Rwanda, as with any country, there are tiers of income. And the lower tier traditionally cook with charcoal on clay burners. My general setup is the same as most households, although most people do still prefer to cook in an outside area. But being a Mzungu, I've moved my kitchen inside, which my landlord wasn't too happy about to begin with, but as I haven't burnt down the house in 6 or 7 years, he's kind of grudgingly got used to it. I use a two-hob camping stove and my bucket oven, which I'm about to show you how I use. You can also buy ovens, but they are quite expensive. And not just to buy, I mean, a friend gifted me one, but I ended up selling it just because I'm so used to cooking like this, I didn't need it. And also because the oven worked off electricity, and for me and the small amount of cooking that I do, electricity sort of works out a bit more expensive, I think, than gas. People don't believe me when I say this, but I get through a bottle of gas. Possibly it takes me sometimes 9 to 12 months to do that. That's, you know, how little cooking I do. And I tend not to put my gas bottle on full, so it's not sort of burning tons of gas. So moving on to making the pastry, I'm using azam flour, which is very common. I don't tend to measure anything when I cook. I just throw everything into a bowl and hope for the best. So I'll put in about as much flour as I reckon I'm going to need to cover the pan and most of my table. I am a filth monster. I do create chaos and mess wherever I traipse. So this is not going to be beautiful by any stretch of the imagination. Then I've got inyanji butter. So this is locally made butter. So in the UK, you take out a block of butter, you put it in the butter tray, and you just use it bit by bit over the course of a few weeks. But here in Rwanda, the temperature is so much higher that you either keep it in the fridge where it turns into concrete, or you leave it out, and like this, I've left it out slightly too long and it turns to absolute mush. But butter being an expensive commodity, I'm definitely going to use this. So I'm about to make some very, very, very messy, yucky crumbs. And again, I'm just going to guess at the amount on this. I don't really care so long as it's rollable and it ends up, and it ends up covering the tin. Oh yeah, that's horrible. That's really badly done. So at this point, I'm probably likely to throw in a little bit of turmeric, some black pepper, because I love black pepper, maybe a little bit of paprika, and some garlic powder. Give it a bit more of a little bit of a stir about. Then I'm going to be adding a little bit of water and starting to bring the mixture together. I'm not a fan of putting my hands in the goop. So what I tend to do is I use a fork to stir it up until it's looking like it's Play-Doh, and then I'll put my hands in there and mash it about a bit. Like I said, there is absolutely no finesse to this whatsoever. Maybe I can put my hands in that. Yeah. Give it a bit of a knead. On a need to know basis only. Ha 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 ha. That looks like a good and decent lump of potential pastry. Next, using a little bit of that butter just to grease the tin. I would usually do that with kitchen towel rather than my hands, but my hands are clean and I have no kitchen towel, so let's just make sure that's nice and glossy. There we go. So that's ready for the pastry once it's rolled. Okay, because I'm messy and I know that I'm messy, I tend to roll out my dough on a piece of tin foil. Just because it's fairly non-stick. And it minimises my risk of getting flour absolutely everywhere. I'm just going to give that a bit of a... I think I might actually have too much dough this time. Oops. See, I'm actually rolling it on top of something. That is how much of a mess I make. Oh, it's nice and soft though. Let's see if it's gonna hold together. Okay, I'm gonna roll this out nice and thin. That's really looking nice, actually. I think melted butter was the key to this. It's really fluffy and soft. The other nice thing about doing it on foil is if it gets too thin, you can just take the foil and flip it over on the pan rather than trying to pick it up and having it tear. Okay, so I literally just did the flip trick. So I picked up the foil and I just flipped it over onto here, which has almost worked. Give it a little bit of movement. So now I'm just going to press it all down into the edges of the tin. Oh. Sorry, this is not a good quality video. My camera is very, very poor for this, but low quality video means that I stand half a chance of uploading it later. Honestly, internet can be very, There's a bit of patchwork going on there. I'm just going to trim around the edges because I can always use the pastry for something else later. I believe this is called rustic. This is like cottage baking. Definitely not how Nana used to do it. So I've got a little bit of this left over for later. I might make a little pie or something out of that. Okay, next up is the egg. So I'm never too sure how many to put in here. I'm gonna put in 4. Okay, so these eggs are, they're not battery farmed, they're deep litter farmed. And they kind of arrived in Rwanda, I don't know, several years ago, because before this, the eggs were always a lot smaller and white. So when you go shopping, you can request igi umunyarwanda, which is Rwandan eggs, local eggs, or you've got, exotic eggs, as they're sometimes called, because these are kind of the eggs that you're used to seeing in the UK. Whenever I can, I try to buy free range eggs. If you're looking for a free range, I'll put a link in the description below. So traditionally, Rwandan chickens were free range by nature, but now deep litter farming has come in and most eggs that you will buy now will be deep litter. And we're using local inyanje, like the butter, UHT milk, which is the standard that you find. You find it either a full fat whole milk, which I always buy, or I think there's a semi-skimmed green one. So again, I don't really measure anything. I just pour it all in there and I give it a good old whisk around. Again, a little smoosh of salt and a little bit of black pepper is always helpful. Big fan of black pepper. And then we're just going to give it a whisk. My thing is, I tend never to make enough of the batter. But it doesn't matter, because if you pour it in and it's not enough, you can always make some more. So the tin's ready and the batter's ready. So now we're moving on to the filling, to the vegetables. And that's what I really like about quiche, is you can put just about anything in one. So today I've got a manchial piece of broccoli. I've got an aubergine that's definitely past its sell-by date. And I've got a large onion. And another interesting thing in Rwanda is that onions are usually red. So often you pay more for the white onions, whereas in the UK it's the other way around. It's the red onions that are considered a bit exotic. But it's good because I prefer red onions. I think they're sweeter. Okay, so I'm just frying up the onions here because onions make everything taste better. Using a bit of olive oil, but you can use any kind of cooking oil or even ghee. Okay, so I've not completely fried the onions, I've just softened them up a bit. And that's the same with all the veg. I'm not completely cooking it, I'm just softening it a bit. Because it's going to go in the oven for about, I guess, 45 minutes-ish. So I'm just going to put a layer of softened onion on the bottom there. You can sprinkle any more seasoning that you like on here. So this broccoli is definitely a bit dry and shriveled, but the nice thing about broccoli is if you fry it in butter, it goes green and succulent again pretty quickly. So just scattering this around, trying to get a bit of even coverage so that each bite has got a little bit of broccoli. So last but not least, I'm also softening up the aubergine, which is also called eggplant for many people. And I tend to slice this pretty thinly because I'm going to layer it on top of the quiche. So again, not completely cooking it, just getting it to sweat a little bit. Now, just before I put the aubergine in, I have actually got a little bit of dry rosemary. So I'm just going to crush a bit of dry rosemary about it. Basil also works really nicely, any herbs you've got. Or just more salt and black pepper. So you can never have enough black pepper. So my general method is to do a quick pass with the egg and the milk. And then I'm going to put the aubergine on top. And then I'm just going to put the rest of my eggy milky mixture on. Okay, now for the piece de resistance. You can never have enough cheese on a quiche. Rwanda does make a lot of cheese. 99.9% of it is Gouda, if you're British, or Gouda, if you can pronounce things properly. Go. That should be enough cheese. Okay, so my microphone conked out. Let me just explain how the bucket oven works. So underneath the quiche, we have a smaller tin bucket inside a larger one. All of this is resting on top of the gas hob. If you don't have a smaller tin, you can even use a tin can, open at both ends. Just remember to peel off any paper labels first. Now, it's a good idea to turn the small tin rim side up. If it's upside down, then the bottom of the tin acts like a hot plate. The heat will transfer across the bottom of your quiche tin, loaf tin, or whatever you're using to cook in,
and your food stands a higher chance of burning on the bottom. There's no fan assistance here, so the heat isn't evenly distributed. If you turn it rim side up, then less of the surface area is in contact with your food, and this reduces the risk of burning. I'm just going to preheat the oven before I start baking, so I'm removing the quiche and popping the lid on, which is just a thin circle of metal. The lids are very rarely completely flat, so there will always be a bit of ventilation around the top, but you want to try to close it as much as possible. Then we're just turning the gas fairly high and giving it a couple of minutes to heat up. When you're working with a bucket oven, you need to be extremely careful with your hands because it's really easy to burn yourself. I use a knife and tea towel to lift the lid, then very gingerly lower the quiche in. If you have oven gloves, now's the time to use them. Pop the lid back on, then lower the heat to a steady burn. This is probably going to take about 40 minutes to cook.
The most important thing for me is my nose. So providing you don't have COVID, providing you've got a half decent sense of smell, then you will know when your food is ready. Because you saw my hob, the dial, there's no number on that at all. There's no way of telling exactly what temperature that bucket oven is at. But I can go away, I can do what I need to do on the internet, I can call up my friends for a chat, and generally speaking, with something like a quiche or banana bread or any sort of baked good, your house will fill up with this wonderful scent of cooked food. Now, if you're unsure, you should always pop back. You can use your knife, your towel, just to peek in. With a quiche or a cake, you can put your knife in, and if it comes out clean, then the food is probably ready. So definitely check on it, but really rely on your sense of smell as well and looking at the food. Because, you know, if you really just go by the recipe cook time, it probably isn't likely to work for you. But the more dishes that you burn, the better you're going to get at not burning them. The more you're going to develop that sense of when your food is ready. All right, guys, moment of truth. It's actually been closer to about 50 minutes because I realised I had it on a little bit too low, so I turned it up for a while. It smells good. My house smells amazing. It smells of melted cheese, fried onions, and pastry. So it's smelling good. Let's have a little look inside and see what we've got here. Be careful with this, otherwise I'll burn my fingers off. Oh, look at that. It is sizzling. Oh, look at it. Look at that buttery sizzle around the edges. Yep. The pastry looks cooked but not burnt. I'm not too sure. I think that's cheese on the tip rather than soggy egg. Let me blow it and taste it. Yeah, that's cheese. Yeah, and you can see around the edges that the egg is set and puffed up. That looks absolutely delightful. That's exactly what I wanted when I set out to make it. So what I'm gonna do is I'm just gonna turn off the gas and I'm going to pop the lid back on for a little bit, say goodbye to that delightful looking lump of melted cheese. So I'm just gonna let that cool down in there because it won't burn now that it's off, but it will just finish cooking if there's anything left in there to cook. But that to me looks like I stopped it at exactly the right point.
It's like ha 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 ha. That's good. The rosemary was a good idea. black pepper. This is exactly what I wanted. And that'll keep me going for a few days. And yeah. Bon app. Muri Hegwe.